In this video, we'll describe how I replaced all the brake lines in a 2000 Suburban. I'll show you a valuable lesson I learned about how to apply heat to frozen bleeder screws in cast aluminum calipers. And I'll show you some valuable details that will save you some time and make it easier if you need to do this yourself. Good morning. Today we're dealing with the second of a two-part series describing a major overhaul of the braking system in a 2000 Suburban. You'll recall in the first episode we removed the EBCM and resoldered the board in an effort to deal with an intermittent ABS light on the dash. Today we're dealing with a hydraulic brake line leak just in front of the left rear wheel. I hope you stay tuned. Some of these lines are pretty stuck and they're very hard to get out, so I'm going to cut this one just to make it easier to get out. Some of these rear connections are a bit tricky because we're so tight in here, but there's a single brake line that comes to the rear, and that brake line leads to this hose here. There's a clamp and a hose, and then from the hose it splits into two smaller diameter lines, one going to the left rear, one to the right rear. And so right now we're going to work on getting the one above undone. That's deep in there. Let's see if I can give you a shot of it. Not sure if you can see it there. I'm going to take this off to bleed it on the bench. Okay, I think you can see that I got most of the lines out here. What you'll notice is a dramatic difference between the rusted areas and the relatively unrusted areas. I cut most of the lines just to make it easier to get some of them out. And I've got the culprit line out as well. And that's this one right here. And I think the area that's was actually leaking is somewhere in this 6-inch segment here. And so that's nicely removed. This is the line that was going to both rear wheels. I should mention how these lines come off the ABS unit. Here's a shot looking back towards the rear of the vehicle at the ABS unit where the lines enter. The line on the top left goes to the driver's side front wheel. The middle one goes to the passenger side front wheel. And the line at the top right goes to the Jounce line, and from there it splits to go to both rear wheels. The two bottom lines go to the master cylinder. On my vehicle, the one on the right, as shown here, goes to the front connection at the master cylinder, and the one on the left goes to the rear master cylinder. Not surprisingly, all of my bleeder screws are frozen, and I learned a valuable lesson when using oxyacetylene. With frozen bolts in general, the conventional approach is to apply heat to the female end and then spin it off while hot. You can't do that with cast aluminum. On this first caliper, I tore out the aluminum threads and I had to replace the caliper. On the next three calipers, I used the approach I'm showing here. I applied heat only to the bleeder screw itself, then quenched the screw and waited for it all to completely cool down. The thermal expansive shock breaks the corrosion free, and by letting it cool down, you avoid tearing out the aluminum threads. You can see I'm using a cutting torch here. In retrospect, I should have taken the time to switch to a smaller brazing tip to more carefully direct heat at the base of the bleeder, keeping heat away from the vulnerable bleeder tip. I get frustrated when I see bleeder screws without plastic end caps. Look at this bleeder screw. Notice how much corrosion there is on the deep end. This bleeder had no cap on the end, so moisture was able to penetrate through the end hole and eventually form a calcified blob that completely obstructed the hole leading to the tip. Even if you're able to get this bleeder screw out, it's never going to work until you clean out the passageways on the bench. For those of you who are doing this yourself, here's a parts list of what I ordered. I can see why some people would want to save some money and just fix the line that's leaking, but if one line fails, others are sure to follow, and so it can be a false economy and more risky to wait for the next catastrophe. When you save money on labor, you can spend a little more on parts and do things more thoroughly. I decided to replace all the lines and all five flexible hose connections at the same time.
This part here is a kit of pre-bent lines and fittings. I discovered that this kit is missing the two sections of smaller 3/16 line that goes to the rear wheels, so I ended up buying steel line locally and flaring and bending those myself.
The next step is to put it into the flaring tool, and you can see the punch I've used there. I want the height to be just about there. And to do the double flare, you put this in like so. Make sure it's square and then tighten it up like crazy. Good. Or you just put the flaring tool in by itself.
The popular alternative to steel lines is to use an alloy of nickel and copper, sold as NICOP. These lines are more malleable, more durable, less prone to rust, and almost four times more expensive than steel lines. My local parts dealer don't keep NICOP lines in stock, presumably because of their high cost. So I chose steel lines so I didn't have to wait for a special order.
Getting these lines off is pretty awkward, laying underneath the car, especially if it's raining. I wish I'd have parked the car indoors because now I'm laying in the mud. But basically, one of the most difficult connections is this Jounce cable, this one right here. And this allows the frame of the body to bounce up and down. The quarter inch line that comes to the two rear wheels hooks in here. And you take the spare tire off, reach up, you still won't be able to see it. There's a 13 millimeter bolt, and just spin this bolt off, and then this makes it easier to see. Now this Jounce cable ends up at a T intersection where the two 3/16 lines, the smaller 3/16 lines, hook in here. There's another bolt holding it in place, and you get it off, and here's our replacement. And so we're gonna have to swap over this little bracket. Give you a shot of what we're looking at here. This is the old line here and hooks in there and then goes to this central Jounce line that hooks in right here, and then this line goes up and in behind, and there's a 13 millimeter stud that's held onto there that you just have to work at by feel, and that's it. Now here's the new line, and so I'll just put the camera down and bend that into place. So when you buy pre-bent lines, they have to come in a box, and of course they have to be parceled in such a way that they can be sent by mail. And so what they've done is they have these bends that are put into the line that don't belong there, and you can see there are three spots here on this one where I'm going to have to straighten this out once I get it into the car. This is the line for the right front wheel, and that's the project today. We're just gonna put this line into place.
These lines easily flex, allowing me to temporarily bend them to slide them into place. Even so, this part is a struggle to get the lines positioned correctly. A real tradesman is very careful here because you don't want those new lines to be rubbing on steel or wiring harness or exhaust parts that might cause more problems a few thousand miles later. You wanna take your time and do this correctly.
Okay, we're putting the right front wheel line on now, and of course the nightmare here is to cross thread this thing at the ABS, but so far I seem to be okay. We're on the right front wheel, and I'll just show you a little bit of a difference comparing the aftermarket to the OEM. The OEM's got this little twist here, and the aftermarket just comes straight off, just mounting at a 45 degree angle, but otherwise the connectors seem to go on pretty well.
Here I'm taking the master cylinder reservoir off to better clean the reservoir before reinstalling it. The reservoir is held in place by a couple of roll pins that you tap out with a small size drift punch. On removal, I damaged the roll pins enough that I replaced them with similar sized cotter pins. Once those roll pins are out, you can pry the reservoir off the MC. At the bottom of the reservoir are a couple of O-rings that make the seal. You can more effectively clean the reservoir from below. However, because the reservoir has internal baffles, I wasn't able to clean it as much as I would have liked.
Now, as you saw, I took the reservoir right off and tried to clean this. I managed to get it cleaned pretty well on this side, but on this side you can still see some dirt on the walls. And short of replacing the master cylinder reservoir, that's about as clean as I'm going to be able to get it. Now, I've hooked up my tubes for bench bleeding here on the table, and we'll just put some brake fluid in here and get all the bubbles out on the bench. This is the Dorman kit for bleeding the MC, and as you can see, it uses black tubes, which isn't that great if you want to see the bubbles coming through to tell whether or not your bubbles have gone. But you can also look for bubbles in the top of the fluid as well, and I don't see the point in replacing the tubes just for the sake of cosmetics, so.
The point of bench bleeding is to evacuate compressed air bubbles that are trapped by the two pistons inside the master cylinder before you reinstall the MC onto the car. You can do this on the car if you want to, but bleeding will take significantly longer if you have to start by sending air down the brake lines initially. I'm intermittently pushing on a rod with a blunt end to mimic what happens when you pump the brake pedal. Those two black tubes route the fluid and air back to the top of the reservoir, and any air bubbles that are sent along the black tubes bubble innocently out the top of the reservoir. In retrospect, I should have spilled the first few ounces so that any dirty fluid trapped inside the MC was discarded. By replacing all the lines, I was able to dodge the complexity of installing extra unions. Unions for brake lines need to have the same design of flared ends on both sides with custom fittings that hold them together. Just remember that compression fittings with a sliding ferrule that crimps the line are never appropriate or even legal for brake lines.
Fortunately, this fluid doesn't leak all over the place. While you're doing that, the amount of fluid that drains is fairly minimal. The fact is that while bleeding, nothing comes for quite a while. The other thing is it's sometimes hard to tell whether you're getting an air leak from the nipple itself or whether you're getting air from inside the caliper and the brake tubes. Let's try this again. And it's always a good idea to check your connections after. Interestingly enough, that one in the center at the top, which goes to the right front wheel, was leaking just a tad. I put a wrench on it and tightened it up, and it seems to have dried up a little bit. So I think the line was going in just a slight angle on tightening it up, straightening it out. This one here was leaking a tad as well, right at that connection right in there. And so I took it all off while it was actually bleeding, cleaned it all up, put it back together again, tighten it up, and it's fine. Well, overall, I'd say this job was harder than I anticipated, but I'm certainly glad it's done. It'll remain to be seen whether the ABS light stays off or whether it comes back on me in the next few weeks. I'll keep you posted on that, and I'll update the video. Say, if this video helped you out and you want to see more of them, then hit like or subscribe or leave a remark. That kind of activity makes it easier for others to find it. Thanks for watching.